Hi, I'm Pastor Matt. I want to welcome you to Cross Point Church's online worship service. Thank you for joining us. We pray that the worship today will guide you into God's presence, may speak to you, challenge you, encourage you, and remind you of His power, hope, and love. Now, as you prepare yourselves to worship, I want to encourage you to ready your hearts. Find somewhere comfortable to sit where you can join us with minimal distractions. You can now take this time to silence or to turn off your phones. And I want to encourage you to have your Bible, a journal, and a pen ready to follow along the message and to take some notes. And if you have children, we encourage you to sing together and worship as a family. Now let's take a moment right now to pray and ask God to ready your mind and heart to come into His presence.
From heights of heaven to darkest night, the mission of the Father's heart upon your mind. Nothing would stop you. Beneath the burden, you felt the weight. You held the tension of the price you have to pay. Nothing would stop you. Bless the one who reigns forever. Bless the one who ransomed me. From death to life there is no other. Bless the only risen King. The Lamb of glory poured out for us at Calvary, your body broken on the cross. Nothing would stop you. The lion storming through gates of hell, defeated death, and then you came back from the dead.
Bless the one who reigns forever. Bless the one who
has arise. Faith of God, go before, lift me up as a way. Eyes of God, look upon, be my sight. As a way. Above and below,
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. You rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not live, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who is resurrected.
Hello everyone, I'm Pastor Leung of Crosspoint Church. Welcome to worship with us online. From the second Sunday of February to the end of the month, it is our mission month. Let's recall some of the mission efforts Crosspointers have been involved in the past.
弟兄姐妹们，大家平安！真的很感谢神，这十五年来， 是神的怜悯使用我们少数民族宣教中心在东南亚大山的里面。
In particular, we are going to be focusing this year on some of the unreached people groups that haven't heard the gospel. We have Christopher, a missionary from the Bay Area who have served Muslim communities in the Far East for 14 years. He will also give a lecture on how to evangelize the Muslims in the afternoon. You are welcome to register at our website. One administration reminder, your 2020 donation summary has been letter mailed to you for tax purposes. Any questions, please contact our finance department. For other events and activities, please take a look at our website. Next week, I shall see you again in the air.
Hi, good morning. Welcome to Crosspoint. I'm Pastor Matt, and I'm glad that you're here today with us, and I'm glad that you could worship with us this morning. And today we're actually continuing our sermon series on worship. And it's such an important aspect of the Christian life. It's such an important aspect of our daily lives. And yet, sometimes it's something that can be drastically overlooked. We tend to only focus on worship as something that we do on Sunday rather than something that we actually follow throughout the rest of our lives, in our everyday lives. And I think what happens sometimes is that we end up going through the motions of our faith. We end up kind of being stuck in a rut, and we actually don't really realize how we can actually worship God every day. And I think one of the things that happens is that we become disconnected from God's presence. And because what happens is that on Sundays, what happens is that we just come here out of habit. And we come here rushing from our homes, typically back before we were meeting a pandemic, and now we just kind of like rush to just click play button on our YouTube, or we just wait till a more convenient time for us to press play and to join the worship service online. And unfortunately, what I think that reveals to us is actually our heart towards God. When God is not the priority, when coming to gather together as God's people to worship Him isn't a priority, or actually it becomes something more of a hindrance or a nuisance to the things that we want to do the rest of the day, it reveals how far our heart is from God. I can remember growing up in church very easily. The first thing that I was thinking about when I was going to church was first seeing my friends, getting to hang out with the people that I liked and enjoyed. And then the second thing was, what are we going to get for lunch? It's like, what do I want to eat? What do I feel like? You know, what can we do to hang out afterwards? And to be honest, growing up in the church, the last thing on my mind was, I wonder what God has to say to me today. The last thing in my mind, to be honest, was, man, I'm coming to church to be in God's presence. And unfortunately, I think that's an attitude that so many of us carry. And it's not on purpose. It's not, our intention. But unfortunately, that's kind of where our heart is at times. Because the things of this world, the things of this life, and the busyness of life take precedence, consumes us, overwhelms us more than God's presence in our lives. You know, in today's society, especially here in America and Western society, we live in that instant gratification type of culture. We live in that fast food culture. We live in the high-speed internet culture. And you know, many of you have heard me before. I've talked about this, that when we're on the internet, if a page takes more than 1 or 2 seconds to load up, we get annoyed. If we have to wait more like 30 seconds, we think about, man, do I need to troubleshoot? Oh, do I need to complain? And it's the same thing when we're waiting for our food, right? When we're going through drive-through, we want this instant gratification. And we treat God the same way.
And when we come to church, our attitude isn't one of that we're here to worship the God who is worthy. We're here to worship the God who loves us. We're here to worship the God of all creation. We come with the mindset of, God, what can you do for me today? We come with a mindset to actually demand things of God. We live in this, not only what can you do for me, but what have you done for me lately attitude. See, even though we may have seen the goodness of God and we've experienced his power in our lives, we want that instant gratification. And if for some reason we feel like God has provided in some way, we say, God, where are you? Why aren't you here? And we carry that attitude towards God in worship. I want to challenge us today to think about this. Not only on Sundays, but every day. When you come with the intention to be before the Lord, is it only to have one of your needs met? Is it only to gain something in this life? Is it only for us to, in a sense, be entertained when you come to church on a Sunday morning? Or do you actually truly desire to be in the presence of God? Brothers and sisters, I think our struggle, what happens in our struggle is that we've forgotten who God is. As crazy as that sounds, like, how can I forget who God is? And maybe intellectually in our minds we haven't, but in our hearts, in the way that we carry out our lives, in the way we approach fellowship and worship and time spent in his word, reveals to us that our desire isn't really to be with the Lord. Today we're going to be in the book of Isaiah, and I'm hoping that we can remember who God is, and specifically one truly important aspect of God that actually Scripture upholds above all other aspects of God, but one that we often overlook. And if we grasp and hold on to that truth of who God is, I think what it will do, it will help us worship more in his presence. Not only when we come on a Sunday to listen to a sermon, when we gather together, but in every day when we seek to follow after him. And so if your Bibles, you can please turn to Isaiah chapter 6. And we're reading verses 1 to 8. And this is the book of Isaiah. Isaiah is being a prophet for God. And this is the word of the Lord. It says this: in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim, or angels. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here I am, send me." Just some brief context for Isaiah. In chapter 6, Isaiah here is actually recounting kind of the story, if you will, of his calling from God to be his prophet. Now, a prophet was an intermediary for God. He was someone who was the voice of God to the people, and he interceded with God on the people's behalf. And so God would bring his word to his prophets, and the prophets would bring it to his people.
And that was the calling that God had placed on Isaiah. Now, what we need to understand is why Isaiah decided to share kind of his story here rather than in the first five chapters. We're not going to read the whole first five chapters. I'm just going to talk about it briefly. But the first five chapters of Isaiah are actually visions that the Lord had given Isaiah. And what most scholars come to understand is that chapters 1 through 6 are not in any chronological order. But there's a reason for why they ordered it this way. You see, the first five chapters of Isaiah is pretty much God pronouncing judgment on his people. Many times about how they have rebelled against God, how they have become murderers and idolaters and adulteresses. And God is constantly speaking of his judgment that will come upon them, the wrath that will come upon them. But ultimately also how God will still call them back to him in repentance. And so Isaiah here in chapter 6, when he is speaking about his calling, he's revealing this vision that he received from the Lord. What he's trying to do is he's actually giving the people an answer to their problems that God has levied against them in the first five chapters. See, here Isaiah is actually demonstrating how a sinful nation can still become the Lord's servants, how they can still become a kingdom of priests. And in doing this, he reveals to them how they ought to approach God. And from that, we can glean how we need to approach God in worship. And as I read through and I studied through Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8, there were four A's of worshiping in God's presence that I found, that I gleaned from him. And the first one is this: if you want to come to the Lord and you want your worship to be impactful, meaningful, the first thing that we need to do is that we need to appreciate God's holiness. Appreciate God's holiness. In verse 1, it says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple." Now, real quickly, I want to talk about, who is this King Uzziah? Why did Isaiah feel it was necessary to bring up King Uzziah? Now, if you know the Old Testament, you know that the line of kings were not exactly good role models. But King Uzziah was one of the few who God had considered to be righteous, to have followed him. He was considered the greatest king since Solomon. You see, after Solomon, there was line after line of king in which the scripture would describe them as they did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And King Uzziah is one of the few where it's like, oh, he was actually one of the few that followed the Lord. And so here we see a good king. But here's something we need to also understand. Towards the end of his reign, King Uzziah actually faltered. As he reigned, he grew in arrogance and pridefulness. And in that pridefulness, he went into the altar, into the temple of God, and he went to the altar of God, which is reserved only for the priests who were set aside by God to offer sacrifices. He went into the Holy of Holies himself, saying that he would provide the sacrifice. And even though the priest told him that he shouldn't do this, he shunned them away. And as soon as he went, God struck him with leprosy on his forehead. And he ran out. And what happened was that he had to live in a separate palace. And his son actually ruled in his stead because of his state. Now, why is this important? It's important because King Uzziah mirrors Israel. He mirrors how they were God's people, and yet they faltered. And because of their sin, they faced judgment. And this is important because, again, as we look at Isaiah's calling, one of the great things that we need to understand is how God redeems his people. But what we need to understand first and foremost is who God is. And that first aspect is God's holiness. And continuing in verse 2, it says this. He says, above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And I know that it's an image that's hard to kind of imagine, because we typically don't have this kind of, when we think of angels, we typically think of like a human in a white robe with wings, with a halo around its head. But here it paints actually a very different picture. And the seraphim actually, in the original language, kind of refers to a burning one. A burning serpent, in a sense. And so it's kind of hard to picture that. But what I want us to focus on is the wings. Why six wings? Why was the face covered? Why were the feet covered? For us, it's to understand the holiness of God. That even the angels could not face God's full glory. That it was too brilliant, too awesome, too wonderful even for them. And for them to cover their feet was one of modesty, in a sense. And feet in the Old Testament times often was referred to as being unclean, because you know you're walking out and it's covered in dirt. And so we understand that even the angels cannot look upon God's glory. And it continues in verse 3. And this is what they cry out to one another, is holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory, and the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. I don't know if you guys have ever been to a concert where it's so loud that you need to put earplugs in, and where you can feel the bass like in your body. It's like boom, boom, boom. Now imagine that, but 1,000 times more, where even the walls are shaking, the floor is shaking. That is the power that is coming out of these voices. And what they are crying out is, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. Now this is important. Do you know that in Scripture, holy is the only word, the only attribute of God that is repeated 3 times? It's what's known as, I'm going to probably say this wrong, but a trisagon. And what it means is repetition. What it means is that it refers to completeness. It refers to the highest level. It's the greatest. And so when they say holy, 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 yes, it's for emphasis, but even more, it's saying that holiness is complete in God. So God doesn't act holy. God is holy. And in all of Scripture, no other word is repeated 3 times. Scripture doesn't say God's love, 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 or his wrath and wrath and wrath, or his mercy, mercy, mercy. No, the emphasis is his holiness. What we need to get across and what we need to understand is the supreme glory and majesty of God. I tried looking for an image of Isaiah 6, and this was the best I could come up with that seemed relatively accurate. And I don't know if you can see it, but it's kind of hard to put yourself in this picture where you're going to see angels flying around you, covering their face with the pillars shaking, and the train of God's robe is filling the temple. I want you to imagine like you're in the largest stadium that you've ever been into, whether you're at a concert, a sporting event, or whatever it is. And in there is the glory of God, blinding light, angels crying out, holy, 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 and his robe is filling the whole arena. It's hard for us to imagine, but that speaks of the glory of God. It's almost too wonderful and too big for us to understand. And the closest comparison I can think of is the sun. It's the blinding sun. It's 93 million miles away, and we still can't stare at it directly, not without hurting ourselves or with sunglasses or other, you know, protective devices. We can't touch it because it's so far away. And even if we did touch it, what would happen? We would die.
That is the holiness of God. But I think so often what happens is we belittle that holiness. We tend to focus more on kind of the other aspects of God that we like his love. We love to say that God is love, that God loves me. But when we say that God is holy, sometimes we don't even realize what we're saying. That when we say he is holy, that he is set apart, not only set apart, he is far greater and far above us. That he is the creator of all things. He created you and me, everything that we see in this universe. He spoke into existence. And in his holiness and in his purity, he is set apart. We don't focus enough on his holiness. Because I think sometimes we're afraid of it. We're afraid because we know our own unholiness. And in some ways, in our culture, to say that we're trying to be holy is almost offensive, right? When we talk about God, when we share about God, we often talk about his love, and we talk about his forgiveness. We talk about how we're striving to be more loving like God. But how many of us say that I'm trying to be holy like God? It almost sounds arrogant, right? It almost sounds conceited. But that is what God has called us to be holy because he is holy. So we need to understand his glory, his majesty, his perfection, his holiness, and appreciate God for who he is. When we tend to focus on other things besides God's holiness, what happens is that we actually demean God. In his book, Yawning at Tigers, You Can't Tame God, So Stop Trying, Drew Dyke said this: the cruel irony of choosing God's love over his holiness is that we end up losing both. The affection of a familiar buddy deity isn't worth much. Only the love of the Lord of heaven and earth, who dwells in unapproachable light, is truly awe-inspiring. When we lose sight of God's greatness, his love loses meaning. When we come to worship the Lord, whether it's on a Sunday, whether it's in our time with the Lord, we need to dwell and we need to appreciate his holiness. Then we can appreciate even greater his other attributes. Appreciate his holiness. The second thing that we need to do is that we need to agonize over our sin. Isaiah 5, this is Isaiah's response. He said this, and I said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Isaiah was stricken with fear. And we often talk about how we shouldn't fear God, but let's be real. We ought to fear God because we need to understand our sin. We need to understand our uncleanness. You see, Isaiah, he feared being destroyed by being in the very presence of God, who is the holy, 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 who is the purest being in everything. And this is the thing I want us to notice here. What's Isaiah's first response when he encounters God? It isn't worship. You see, I think that's what we tend to think. It's like when we see God, our immediate response is worship. No, Isaiah here, his first response is confession. It's his awareness of his sin. It's his awareness of how much he deserves God's judgment and wrath. And that's something that we need to understand, that as we come to the Lord in worship, we appreciate his holiness. And because we see God's holiness, we need to see ourselves for who we really are and our true state. You see, because it's in seeing God for who he is that we can see ourselves for who we are. And we need to be honest and give an honest self-reflection, an honest evaluation of our condition. What are the sins in our lives? What are the sins that we carry? What are the sins that we hide from everyone else? What are the sins that we commit in the darkness or when we are when we are alone? And do we recognize that our sin deserves God's wrath? That in the presence of God, our sin would cause us to be destroyed. That we deserve to be destroyed. Because God is holy and in Him, there can be no sin. But what happens, I think, for us is that we often make light of our sin. We make light of the devastation of sin. And so I want to challenge you and ask you guys this, is do you see sin for what it is? Most of us, when we try to justify the sin in our lives, we try to tell ourselves it's not a big deal. We try to tell ourselves it's not hurting anybody. But what we need to see first and foremost is that it is an affront to God. It spits in the holiness of God. Our sin spits at Jesus as He laid on the cross. It is our sin that led Jesus to the cross. It is our sin that put Him there. And for all of what He has done and what has required of God to bring us Jesus, we make light of it. We try to hide it. Some of us even, we relish in it. Do you see sin for what it is? For the devastation that it can cause? And for me, the only thing that I could kind of think of was a tornado. When a tornado kind of rips through a city and through a town and just the devastation it leaves in its wake. And this is a picture of the effects of a tornado that I found on Google. The picture above is a picture from, Google Earth or the Google Street. And you see that neighborhood. And you see the trees and you see the houses. And the picture below it is what happens after a tornado has torn through that neighborhood. It's absolutely decimated, devastated. There's just wreckage left behind. Another image for us is that this is the damage that it leaves in its wake. And the effects of a tornado are long lasting. Even though a tornado, and here's the scary thing. A tornado here on this earth is just a temporary thing. But sin can continue to go on and on in our lives if we don't bring it before God, if we don't put it to death. There's this movie called The Day After Tomorrow, and one scene that always stuck out to me was a scene in which LA gets destroyed, and there's like multiple tornadoes, and from those tornadoes, other tornadoes are forming, and there's this devastation continuously wrecking the city. And even though it's a movie, for me, that's kind of like the image that I see when I think about the devastation left by sin. The hurt it can lead to others, the damage it does to our souls, the damage it does to God's people. Brothers and sisters, do you see sin for what it is? When we make light of it, we then make light of God's grace. But when we can understand the depths of sin and how it separates us from God and how truly ugly and shameful it is, then we can truly accept God's grace with greater appreciation. So that's the third thing. As we appreciate God's holiness, as we agonize over our sin, then we accept His grace. In verse 6 of Isaiah, it says this, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for.'" Do you notice it wasn't Isaiah asking God to cleanse him? God took the initiative. And the seraphim came and he took that coal from the altar and it touched it to Isaiah's mouth. Now, there's some imagery here that we can understand. I'm just going to go through it real quickly. But the altar in which the coal is taken from, obviously, it denotes a sacrifice imagery. And fire itself in the Old Testament often spoke of kind of God's wrath. But here we see that the angels, they use tongs to pick it up. Now, why do these angels, these seraphim, need to pick it up when they themselves are kind of called the burning ones? It's not because it's hot, but because it is holy. The coal is considered holy. And ultimately, all this imagery points us to Jesus. See, that coal represents the finished work of Christ, of Jesus Christ on the cross. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 to 16, it says this. It says, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then, with confidence, draw near to the throne of God, a throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." The imagery in Isaiah points to what Christ accomplishes for us on the cross. That he becomes our high priest, offering the sacrifice. He's a high priest and he's our sacrifice. And because of his sacrifice, our sin is no longer counted against us. And his righteousness is imputed on us. And we are made clean before the Lord. In order for us to really appreciate what Christ has done, we need to again understand the depths of our sin and appreciate God's holiness. I want to go back to that imagery of the imagery of the sun that I used earlier. I talked about how we can't even get near it and yet it blinds us. And if we were even to get near it, that it would burn us up, that we would die. And yet, we are one with Jesus who shines brighter than the sun. Even though angels themselves need to cover themselves, we are brought into his family. And Francis Chan posits this. He says, "Why would someone so extraordinary choose to care for you like his own? Why would someone so extraordinary choose to care for you like his own? Why would he demonstrate such grace and such mercy and such forgiveness towards you?" It's because of his love for us. But again, to appreciate his love, we need to appreciate his holiness. And as we appreciate his holiness and acknowledge our sins, we accept his grace. You see, brothers and sisters, as we come to the Lord in worship, we focus so much on God, what can you do for me? And we forget the greatest thing that God has already done for us through his son, Jesus Christ. That we were dead in our trespasses. That we were headed for condemnation. That we were headed for his righteous judgment. That we were to be separated from him forever. And in his love, he sent Jesus, who bore our sin and shame so that we could one day stand in the presence of God, unashamed, righteous, and holy. The last thing that we need to do as we worship in his presence is then this, is act in faith. Verse 8, Isaiah finishes, and it says this, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me." What was Isaiah's response to being in God's presence? Recognizing God's holiness, recognizing his own sin, recognizing God's grace towards him. It was to act in obedience. It was to respond in faith. Romans 12:1, Paul, he exhorts God's people to do this. He says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. That means ongoing, continuing sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is what? Is your spiritual worship. Here we know that worship is not just activity we do on Sunday, but it's something that we do every day. It's a part of our lives as a living sacrifice to God. When we worship God in His presence, it ought to transform us more into the image of His Son. As we worship in God's presence, it ought to lead us to follow God wherever He calls us to follow Him in obedience. And this is so important because what God desires for us is not just to recognize who He is, it's not just for us to receive His grace, but it's also to live our life in a way that brings Him glory, that points again to His holiness. And so when we come to church on Sundays, when we listen to a message, when we're in God's Word, when we're in the Bible, when we're in fellowship, don't ask, God, what can you do for me today? Or God, what have you done for me lately? Ask yourself, God, how can I respond to your truths out of faithfulness, trusting in who you are, believing what you have already done for me and given to me through your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in this way that when we live in a way that honors God, we are actually worshiping God in our everyday lives. You know, earlier in my message, I asked you guys, when you come to the Lord, are you just looking for a need to be met? And do we actually fail to see that our most important need, our salvation, has already been met through Jesus Christ? And because we know that our eternity is secure in God forever, we can live a life following after Him, a life of worship. I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, I know that at times it's difficult when we seem to be stuck in that rut, when we seem to be going through the motions. But it just takes that one step and another step to bring us closer to God's presence. And so if you're struggling right now, what I want you to do is I want you to take the time today, don't put it off, today, to dwell upon God's holiness. To actually agonize and reflect on your sin. On the things that you're so ashamed of. The things that you hope that no one knows or realizes. The things that you struggle with. And accept the grace of God. And so go to Him in repentance. Confess your need for Him. And turn and respond in faith to the Lord. God will be with you and is with you every day. And I pray that we as God's people would be a people who worship in His presence in every aspect and in every way of our lives. Would you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we recognize your holiness. We recognize that you are so far above us, Lord. We recognize that we are so undeserving to be even called your children. We recognize that how our sin separates us from you, Lord, and how devastating and how ugly and how shameful it really is. And yet, you look upon us with such grace and mercy and love that you gave us your Son, Jesus Christ, to bear our sin and our shame. And so, Lord, I pray, Lord, that when we come to you in worship, that we don't come out of selfishness or self-righteousness, but that we come to you in acknowledging that you are the God who is worthy, that you are the God whom the angels cry out, holy, 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 that you are the God who is worthy of our everything. And though we are so undeserving, and though we are still sinners in need of grace, Lord, that you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And I pray that we would follow after you, that we respond to your truths, that we would forfeit our rights and our earthly pleasures for something greater, which is your Son, Jesus Christ. And help us live a life that is honoring to you. Help us live a life of worship. Help us live a life that is constantly seeking to be in your presence. And in this way, Lord, would you change us? Would you move us? And would you work in us to bring you glory in our families, in our communities, in our city, in our nation, and in the world? And it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me, through the deepest valley he will lead. Been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven, the future sure, the price is has been paid, for Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated, Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the change sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I
I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Thank you for joining us for worship today. We pray that the Holy Spirit spoke to you today, that you were challenged, encouraged, and that you were left with a feeling of hope. I want to invite you to continue to join us for a time of fellowship right after at 12:20 to 12:45. It's during this time where we're going to come together and just share what the Lord has impressed on our hearts, how He's challenging us, how He's speaking to us, and more importantly, how we can live out His truths every day. I want to invite you to check out the link below, or you can check out our church website for more information. So please join us for that time of fellowship and reflection.